right, let's take out our Bibles.
Yeah.
Gospel of John, chapter 4. And I'm going to read from Daniel, chapter 12. You don't need to turn there. I'm just reading one quick verse from the Old Testament prophet Daniel, Daniel, chapter 12. The subject this morning deals with personal evangelism. They use the term soul winning. I never cared for that. Roughly the wrong way to soul winning. There's only one place in the Bible where they kind of use that, those words are used. But I like personal evangelism better. I like the word witnessing. I like those words. That's what God wants us to do, and God's called us Christians to do that. And when a person gets saved and born again, one of the evidences that they are saved and have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, they're going to have a burden for the lost world around them. That's one of the real evidences of someone when they're saved. They're going to have a burden for their family. Sometimes it brings them to tears because they want to see them saved so bad. But they'll have a burden for that. Those are one of the evidences there. Witness when a person really is saved and born again. So we need one of the things we need to learn how to do better, actually, is witnessing. I titled the message this morning, Witnessing to the Woman at the Well. And that's in John chapter 4. I'll read that shortly. But I wanted to read one verse here, Daniel chapter number 12 and verse 3. And it says, and they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament. Now, this is talking about the eternal glory of the Christian. The crown of rejoicing. The witnessing or soul winner's crown, as we call it. The crown is called the crown of rejoicing. The Bible calls that the crown of rejoicing. And it says here, and they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, talking about the future, and they that turn many to righteousness, turning people to righteousness, that means witnessing to them, getting them saved, that's what that means. And they that turn many to righteousness shall shine as the stars forever and ever. So verse 3 again, and they that be wise shall shine. They'll shine like the brightness of the firmament, they'll shine like the stars forever and ever. That's the crown of rejoicing. Daniel chapter 12, verse number 3. That was one of the verses we had to memorize when I was in Bible college, and we went to our personal evangelism class, and I like memorizing that verse. It's a time and a verse that talks about the future, talks about what's going to happen in the future, and the time of rejoicing for the Christian. So let's talk about that right this morning in John chapter 4. We're going to begin reading in verse 1. It's a long chapter and a lot of information here, but I'd still like to read much of it. So John chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. John chapter 4, beginning verse 1. Where the Lord himself is witnessing to the woman at the well, and what the conversation went like. When we witness to people, we have a chance to maybe just invite somebody out to church. Maybe it's no longer than that, inviting somebody out to church. But there's a conversation that goes on. There's a little back and forth a lot of times. And by the way, the outline is in the bulletin this morning. If you want to follow along with the outline for the message, it's in the bulletin. But witnessing to the woman at the well, and what we can learn following the Lord's example here. So what we have this morning in our church is a class on personal evangelism taught by the Lord himself, by his example. A class on personal evangelism taught by the Lord himself and by his example. John chapter 4, beginning verse 1 says, when therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees, that heard that Jesus made baptize more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee, and he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. That's important. Parcel of ground that Jacob, gave to his son Joseph. Now, verse 6. Now, Jacob's well was there, and therefore Jesus, being wearied with his journey, see, the Lord was a real person doing wearied at times. He got tired. being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Then said, now here begins the discussion, a little bit of back and forth here. This will be my main thoughts of my message. Verse 9. Then said the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, who am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. There's a snobbishness there. There's a dislike there. There's even a prejudice there. Then verse 10, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, sir, I like that, sir. I like it when people call me sir. Because in the military, that means you're an officer, sir. The woman said to him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence, then, hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give shall be in him a well of water, springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. In other words, I won't have to come back to this well. Verse 16. Jesus saith unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. Verse 17, the woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands. And he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that saidst thou truly. In verse 19, the woman saith unto him, I always get a little kick out of this. I smile a little bit. In her reaction, your answer. The woman said, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Because he's telling her something that he should not have known, because he didn't know her as far as she knew. He didn't know her before. So how can he know this about her? The only answer is he must have been a prophet then. Now verse 20. And here's her next question. Our fathers worshipped in the mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Looking for a certain place. Places are good at times. Now verse 21. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. What do you mean by that, salvation is of the Jews? It's like my one doctor I have, he's a Jewish man. I had a chance to witness him, talk to him about the Lord. And I said something one time that made him laugh a little bit. I says, you know something? Us Gentiles, we need the Jewish Messiah.
That's right.
And he thought that was a little humorous. He got a smile at that. I thought it made some good points there. And that's true.
That's right.
Us Gentiles, we need the Jewish Messiah.
Amen.
The Savior was Jewish, according to his nationality at least. But the salvation is of the Jews. Amen to that. That's true. Now the Lord continues on in verse 23. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father, now here it is, in spirit and in truth. You need to know what that is. That's not this morning's message. But you need to know the difference between the places. You need to know what worshiping in the spirit is. You need to know what worshiping in the truth is. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. And now the very well-known verse that restates this in verse 24. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Then verse 25, the woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. Mark that in your Bibles. Messiah is Christ, Christ the Messiah. Here it's very clearly brought up. Every time Jesus is called the Christ, or Jesus Christ, it's referring to him as the Jewish Messiah. Christ means Messiah. Isn't it kind of interesting? She knew this too. She had some knowledge about things, didn't she? She knew about where people worship. She knew about certain things. She knew about the Messiah. Very, very interesting. I know the Messiah is coming, which is called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things. Then verse 26, Jesus saith unto her. Now, if this was in the movie somewhere, we ought to have the music pick up in the background. There ought to be this symphony orchestra hitting at the drums being played, because this is a major thing here. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he.
Amen.
I am the Christ.
Yep.
I am the Messiah. Verse 27, and upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, why, what seekest thou, or why talkest thou with her? The woman now, verse 28, the woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and said to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Then they went out of the city, came to him, and so forth. It continues on there. Heavenly Father, help me as I continue preaching this morning. Lord, please, please, may the Holy Spirit of God be able to use this message to make things clear. Please help me. Please use me this morning. In Jesus' name, and for his honor and glory, I pray and ask it. Amen. Amen. Witnessing to the woman at the well. Point number one, we need to follow the Lord's example of how to witness. We need to witness as Christians. We need to make it part of our Christian life. He said, it's a little bit hard for me to just start talking to people or to witness to people. I know, it's hard for me too. I'm the pastor of the church, been here, 42 years, and been saved over 50 years now, and it's still a little bit difficult. It does get easier as the time goes on, but let the Lord be an example here. Let the Lord be an example. The woman at the well, that's an example of how the Lord witnessed. The rich young ruler, when the Lord witnessed that rich young ruler that came to him, and he made an issue of his wealth and his money. He said, go sell all that you have, come follow me, and you'll treasure in heaven. And the rich young ruler went away sorrowful, went away still lost. He came to the Lord lost, he left the Lord, went away from the Lord, still lost. But that's an example for us. The Lord always does things the right way and the best way, doesn't he? So the woman at the well, the rich young ruler. How about Nicodemus, when the Lord personally witnessed to Nicodemus? And Nicodemus did not believe on the Lord then when he left, but he did later on. What about the Pharisees? The Lord witnessed to the Pharisees so many times. But let's learn how to deal with people. Let's learn about our personal witnessing, personal evangelism, by following the example of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. How he did things. How he handled himself. Let's learn from his example. He's always perfect in everything he does, including how to witness to people. Number two, he initiated the conversation. He started talking first. First. To be saved, to be converted, a person needs information. People need to learn things, and they hear things that they haven't learned before. They need to hear things they've never heard before. Information needs to go back and forth. Information needs to be given out. And here was the Lord talking to this lady, gave her this information. Now we can learn things through living the Christian life too. In 2 Peter, is it, where Peter talks about one lady who wants to get her husband saved, and he says to her, live the Christian life in front of him. If nothing else is working, live the Christian life in front of him. Maybe that'll work. But information has to be given, it has to be taught, it has to be learned, it has to be maybe preached or evangelized. But people need to hear what the gospel is. People, 99% of the people on the outside, if not more than that, they do not know what it means to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. They don't know and understand that Jesus Christ is God himself, and yes, he's the Old Testament Messiah. They don't know that out there. We hear that every Sunday in our church, but they don't know that out there. So take what we learn inside here and take it out there and give it to the people who need it out there. He initiated the conversation. I'm not going to say you talk to everybody you run into. I don't know if anybody that's ever done that, But we need to talk to people. You need to witness. Just give out tracts.
Amen.
Maybe just go around and be sneaky in how you give out tracts. I know people come back and they tell me, I was in one place and I left it, it was one grocery store I went to where they have wine and beer. I left our tracks in a lot of places there in those grocery stores. I'm thinking, good. Then I think, is our name and church name on the back of that track? Honestly, it's been years. I know our people give out a lot of tracks and like that too. Our people, it's been years since we had anybody call the church complaining about it.
Good.
It's been a lot of years. We did a number of years ago, but not recently. So keep being sneaky, giving out those tracts. People need that information. So he initiated the conversation. He started the talking here. And she didn't, because there was that separation. There was that nationality separation. Now he was a guy, she was a lady, there was that separation. Because there was a lot of difference back then in that area. Guys didn't talk to ladies, women didn't talk to men. So there was a difference there. But he initiated the conversation, got the information out. And we know how it all turned out. But I just want to bring that up, emphasize that point. Witnessing, initiate the conversation in a nice way, a kind way. You know, keep your right attitude about that. And even if you're a little fearful, so what? If you hand somebody a track and your hand is shaking like, oh, what is this? They know that that does not turn them off. In fact, it might even encourage them to take that track. So seeing how nervous you are about doing that. I don't know. But anyways, somebody's got to start the conversation.
Yeah, right.
Somebody's got to start the ball rolling in that area. Somebody's got to start talking about the Lord. Bring it up. Make it as easy on yourself as you can. I just tell people, well, do you go to church anywhere? You know, they talk to me about, like, at Office Max. That's one of my main places I talk to people. Or just out the neighborhood, post office and grocery stores. I'll just bring up, well, do you go to church anywhere? You know, that's a nice, light way to start a conversation. But start a conversation. Pray that the Lord will help you to do that. Pray that the Lord will give you a little courage there, a little prompting. Pray that the Lord will help you to know what to say, to get things going, but to make it an easy thing. You know, something easy that you can kind of just lean into and go into easily. But the information has to be given. There has to be a conversation. Maybe just inviting somebody out to church where they can hear me preach the Word of God and teach the Word of God. Maybe that's part of it. Give them a track. Which brings up the next thing, next subject here. It aroused your curiosity. She had three questions here. We're going to get into those three questions here in just a minute. But first of all, I want to emphasize, it aroused your curiosity, verse number 9 there, she said, the woman of Samaria, how is that thou, being a Jew, ask and drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. She got curious about this. Did you know people are curious? You know, they're curious about what you believe. You know, they're curious about what happens in our church here. There's people out there say, whoa, what do you do at your church? You can tell they're kind of wondering about us. Are we a cult? By the way, we've been called a cult too, because we believe the Bible. My one cousin Holly, who was saved, she said one day, the word got around on my mom's side of the family. I became a Christian, started going to this Baptist church down there in Key West. Started going to the Baptist church. They said he got involved in a cult. They literally said, I got involved in a cult. I thought, now that's interesting, because you come up here to Cleveland, there's Baptist churches all over the place. There's a big Cleveland Baptist church over there on the west side. At that time, Dr. Roy Thompson was preaching there. And they think Baptists are a cult? Yeah, some of them do. So they're curious, though. They might have heard a lot of negative things or some things like that, but they are curious. People are curious. You know, when we give out those tracts to somebody, they might not seem all that interested. But I wonder.
Yeah.
But I wonder, after you're gone, and when nobody's around, and nobody's going to see them reading that tract, they're going to pull out that tract and they're going to read it. people are curious about that, aren't they? On Blogberg, like I said, it was 86, packets were given out. Some of the packets might have been just discarded. I don't know. I hope not, of course. But I think many of them, when no one else is around, and after the ones that have given out those packets have gone, maybe later in the evening, they'll bring that out. They're sitting on their easy chair in front of you. They'll bring it out, and they'll start looking at that information. Why? Because people are curious. Use that curiosity. Reach people that way. What they might not want to show an interest when they're in public, they do have an interest though. And in private, they'll read that information through. They'll look it over. And we're planting seeds. And we need to do that. We need to plant seeds. So point number three in my outline here. He aroused your curiosity. She had been thinking about these things. When he brought it up, she brought up what she knew already. So, Christian, be faithful in giving out the gospel, giving out the information, giving out those tracts, inviting people out of the church. That's our commercial for this morning. Next point here, the three subjects that were brought up. I found this very interesting. The subjects that were brought up plus how the Lord answered them. The first subject of God was verse number 9. Then said the woman of Samaria to him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? The nationality difference there, the snobbishness there of the Jewish people with the Samaritans. Samaritans were half-breed. They were half Jewish or Israelites, and they were half Gentile. So the Samaritans were looked down upon by the Jews as being not full Jewish people. Being a Jew, ask a drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria. And there was a separation there between men and women back then, too, a very severe thing. For the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. The first thing he had to deal with was this issue about differences there. Nationality differences, racial differences. Look at verse 10, then Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldst ask of him, and he would have given thee living water. What did the Lord's answer be here? What was his answer here? He avoided the subject. He went to the more important things. What is really important? Let's get back to spiritual things, not this problem, not this division between people. Let's talk about the spiritual things. Verse 11, another question she brought up. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep, from whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? She started thinking physical means, like Nicodemus brought up. How can a man be born again? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb? They started thinking about physical things, and the Lord had to bring back the spiritual things. Verse 13. Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh this water shall thirst again. Talking about spiritual things, a thing that is an impossibility. So she wanted to go back to physical things, thinking about the practical things in this life, and he brought the subject back to spiritual things. A third subject in verse 20. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. She brought up worship, churches. We are a Baptist church. We believe what we believe here in our doctrine. We believe our doctrine is correct and right. If I thought somebody else was more right, or somebody else was right, I'd be that, whatever that is. Right. But I believe the Baptists have it right here. But Jerusalem is a place where people ought to worship. Worship the Lord here. And then how did he answer here in verse 21? Basically what he says beginning in verse 21 is, it doesn't matter the place. Two other things are more important. Now, I'm not saying you ought to not understand or realize the importance of the right place, the right church. Right. You need to have the right church with the right doctrine. Amen. But verse 21, the Lord said unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. You worship, you have your church service, so to speak, but you don't know what you're doing. We know when we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Now verse 23. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. He turned every one of these subjects back to spiritual things. Each one of these three subjects, these three things brought up, he brought back to spiritual things, to get her thoughts and mind back on spiritual things. When we witness to people, they'll bring up questions. They can be answered quickly, like the Lord answered quickly some of those. Then get back to the spiritual thing. Don't let them get you off track when you're talking to people and when you're witnessing to people. Get back to the spiritual subjects. Understand they're going to bring up some things. I've had some strange things brought up. Maybe the strangest ever was one young man. He was saying, he seemed really interested. He said, I have one more question. And his question was a strange one. Are there people living on Mars? That was his question. Are there people living on Mars? And I answered that quickly. I said, we don't know. It was important for us to know. It'd be in the Bible. We don't need to know the answer to that question. I don't think there are. I don't believe there are. But if there were, it was important. If it involves God, if it involves our salvation, it would be in the Bible. Then I got back to the Bible things again. But people are going to ask questions. Sometimes you give a quick answer and get back to the spiritual things. Sometimes you just ignore it completely. Now the next thing is a question she did not answer, or I'm sorry, a question she did not ask, but she should have. In verse 16, let's go back there, a question she did not ask, but she should have, but the Lord brought up. Jesus saith unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. There's nothing previous about her family or background in that way. Nothing at all. The Lord brought it up. Because this is a question she should have asked, but she didn't. Now, verse 17. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. She left it at that. Didn't want to get into it more. Didn't want to get into more detail. Jesus saith unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that thou sayest truly. And then the woman said, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. You know what Jesus was doing here? He was bringing up her sin. He was bringing up something she needed to repent of. It's like the rich young ruler. He brought his spiritual problem of money. With the Pharisees, he brought up their spiritual, religious pride. That's a better word, religious pride. So the Lord brings up these things, so they have to be dealt with. They have to be repented of. Sin needs to be repented of. Repentance is part and necessary of salvation. Amen. How do you know if a person really did repent or if they did not repent? Well, if they really got saved, if they really did repent, there's going to be changes after that. You can find out, don't always see it. It might not always be that recognizable. But if a person really got saved, there's a change in their life, and so that they hadn't really repented in their life. And then because there's a change, there's a difference in their life now, it gives evidence of salvation and gives evidence of repentance. Did I make that clear this morning? I started stumbling over those words. If a person's really saved, you'll see it in their lives, and you'll know then that they really have repented.
Right.
Maybe that's clear. Repentance is necessary for salvation. Acts chapter 20, verse 21. Does my go to the Jews and also the Greeks? Repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. My, oh my. People must recognize that they're sinners. They must be convicted of some kind of sin to one degree or another, and they must repent of that sin. They must turn from that sin and turn towards the Lord Jesus Christ. They must turn from wanting to serve self to serving the Lord Jesus Christ. That's repentance.
Amen.
Turning from sin and turning toward the Lord Jesus Christ. There's where salvation comes.
Amen.
He brought it up. Nothing previous was said about that. Why did he bring that up? Because you have to deal with people about their sin. The Holy Spirit of God deals with people about their sin. So he brought up this subject. He had a question that she should have been asking about. But since she didn't bring it up, he did. He did. A next point there, the important subject of who Jesus Christ is. It's so important that she realized the Messiah and Christ would come. We need to understand who Jesus Christ is.
Right.
He said in verse number 26 there, Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Yeah. Here's where it needs to be the music coming in. Here's where it needs to be the loud music coming in. Because a major thing is being said right here. Stop action right there. Think about this, what he just said right here. He says, I am the Messiah. I am Christ. I'm the Old Testament Messiah. I'm the New Testament Christ. I am God Himself. I that speak unto thee am He.
Amen.
What a privileged individual she was to have the Lord Jesus Christ Himself personally talking to her, dealing with her salvation. Did it work? Did she get saved? Absolutely, positively she got saved. But there had to be this. She had to understand who Jesus Christ is. People today are seeking salvation. Stop seeking salvation.
Yeah.
Start seeking Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ is the Savior.
That's right.
And the Savior is the Lord.
Amen.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
Did you get that last statement? The Savior is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the Savior. And the Savior is the Lord. That's so important to understand. She needed to understand who he was. And he told her, I am he.
Amen.
Nobody in this room this morning has had Jesus Christ personally appear and talk to you.
Right.
Nobody has. That's one of the most important reasons for this book.
Yes.
This Bible. The Bible, the Word of God. So we can read these things. And in and through the written word, inspired and preserved over the centuries, we are personally being talked to by the Lord Jesus Christ in this way.
Amen.
In this way.
Amen.
Through his written word. This way he can be everywhere throughout this world, talking to everybody. Anybody who will pick up this Bible and start reading it. I am he. People need to understand who Jesus Christ is. We call some groups cults. The reason we call them cults is because they don't understand that Jesus is God.
Right.
They come up short. They might say he's a prophet, a good man, a good teacher, lived a good life, lived an exemplary life. That's good, that's true, but it's not enough.
Mm-hmm.
You need to go further. Realize he is absolute God himself.
Amen.
And the creator God. The God who's coming back to the judge's world. God himself. Jesus died on the cross for our sins in the flesh. He did that as a man. He did that as a fleshy man. He died for our sins. He was a sacrifice to God the Father. But he was also God himself, too. God himself. What a understanding that people need. Some people, I have had problems with this. Some people I've witnessed to, they want to get saved. They're worried about their salvation. They're worried about, they want to go to heaven. They don't want to go to hell. And that's a good concern. That's an important concern. But they want salvation.
Yeah.
And I try to direct them to Jesus Christ,
right,
because Jesus Christ is the Savior.
Right.
Without Jesus Christ, you're not going to get saved.
Right.
Without Jesus Christ and understanding who he is, you're not going to understand salvation.
Right.
You need to realize and understand who Jesus Christ is. He's God himself who became a man and died for our sins. He was our sacrifice.
Amen.
We're forgiven for our sins as Christians because he took our punishment upon him on Calvary's cross. He is the one. The Savior is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the Savior. And the Savior is the Lord.
Amen.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So stop looking for salvation. No, I shouldn't say that. If you want salvation, you have to look to Jesus Christ. There's the way to say it.
Good.
If you want salvation, look to Jesus Christ. He's the Savior.
Amen.
He's the one that gives salvation and provided salvation for us.
Mm-hmm.
She needed to know that. I that speak unto thee am he.
Amen.
Let the music crescendo right there.
Yes.
Horrible. Honestly, every time I read that verse, I get a little chill.
Good.
I really do. I that speak unto thee am he. Now, did it work?
Yeah.
Did she get saved? Oh, she got saved. How do you know?
Hmm.
Well, let's look at verse 28. 28. Let's look at what she left, where she went, what she said, and her joy. The woman that left her water pot, the water pot is a picture, symbol of the world, the things in this world. She wasn't that interested in the water or water pot anymore, and went her way to the city, had to tell somebody where she went. She went back to the city to tell people what happened to her.
Amen.
That's an evidence of salvation, when people want to tell people what happened to you.
That's right.
Want to witness to people. And went her way into the city and said to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Amen. This is the Christ, the Savior. She got saved here. Yes. And you know that by the reaction. By the reaction. When people get saved, there's a reaction. When people don't get saved. How do I say this? When people don't get saved, there is a reaction. When people don't get saved, there's no reaction. When people get saved, there's a reaction of non-reaction. There's no change. The reaction is they continue on the way they always were. They come to church, hear the gospel preached, maybe, or hear a message from the Word of God, and maybe they make a profession of sorts, but there's no change. There's no change. There's no leaving behind the world like that water pot. There's no desire to go tell people what happened to her. And what she said about Jesus Christ, what she believed now about the Lord Jesus Christ. They don't have the joy. See, when people get saved, there is a reaction. When people don't get saved, there's also a reaction. Just the opposite of a person when they really get saved. Witnessing to the woman at the well. One of the situations we have in our world today are people that claim to be Christians but never went through this situation. They didn't leave their water pots behind. They just took them with them, supposedly. And where do they go? They don't witness to people. They just come out to church or believe, say they believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. But witnessing to the woman at the well, you see all the differences there. You see what's involved in this. Witnessing to the woman at the well. The subjects that are brought up. The time the Lord answered them quickly. The times the Lord avoided those questions. The question he brought up that she did not bring up that needed to be brought up for her to get saved. And then the difference after she got saved. What a difference. What a difference when somebody gets saved. They're born again. What a difference. Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll bless this morning now as we consider these thoughts about the Lord witnessing to this woman at the well. What was involved in it? What doctrines was involved? What truth was involved? What identity. Lord, they need to know who you are. You need to realize you're the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior, the Lord, King of kings, Lord of lords, coming again, and the Savior. The Lord is the Savior. So, Father, I pray that you'll meet spiritual needs today. Work in people's hearts. May they remember what was said this morning, especially the parts that apply to them personally. And bless now this invitation time, this prayer time, as we stand and sing and some come forward to pray about whatever it is. Maybe someone's going to walk the aisle this morning, Lord, to bow the knee before you and to believe on you. Lord, they'd be so excited if somebody would do that. I pray that you meet spiritual needs now and bless this very special, important time too. In Jesus' name, now I pray and ask it.
Amen.
Amen.